So in this video, we'll be looking at community ecology and moving on past the idea of populations and individual species and into the community, which community has a larger connotation. This is the idea of lots of populations coming together. So not just the gazelles, but the gazelles and the bigger gazelles, whatever those things are. And the birds and the trees in the background and all the different things that are combining together to make this community. One of the terms that we will, there's a community. One of the terms that we're going to look at in this talking about community is this idea of species richness. And species richness is the amount of species in an area, not like the population of the monkeys, but how many different kinds of monkeys are there. That it would be a species richness kind of thing. And typically, the more energy available to an area, you know, be it sunlight and water and that sort of thing, the more richness that area is going to have. Communities are often represented by diagrams called food webs. Sometimes you'll see them called rivet models, but I don't see that as much anymore. And a food web basically says this is how different organisms are interacting with one another, or you could think of it as who's eating who. Now, a food web shows us a lot more than that, though. It shows us the importance of each species to the entirety of the ecosystem. So if you take a species like the grasshopper, for instance, what if they go away? Then all the things that eat grasshoppers are going to struggle. Maybe this baboon starts to go down because the thing that it eats a lot of goes down. Well, now baboons aren't there to eat snakes, and apparently snakes aren't there to eat cats. That seems odd, but you get the idea. Taking a piece of the puzzle out of the food web affects the entirety of that food web. And so seeing these kinds of interactions help us to understand the whole ecosystem. And so we're going to look at these different kinds of interactions in the ecosystem. There are different kinds of relationships, and we're going to give each relationship a distinction. So for like a competition, for instance, where two species are competing against each other using resources to find something or to gain something, this would be what we would call a minus-minus relationship, in that both species are losing resources. They're using energy in order to obtain something. In this picture, for instance, you see there's a dead zebra there. And the hyenas want it, the vultures want it, the lion wants it, they're all fighting. So it takes them energy to get the energy. So this is a negative-negative interaction. But then you see the reaction or the interaction between the zebra and the lion. That is one of predation. This is a plus-minus relationship. The lion is getting the meat, the zebra is getting dead. And so obviously that is negative for the zebra. Now, a few more things about competition before we move on with predation. With competition, there is a model called the competitive exclusion model. And competitive exclusion basically says this. It states that each species has its own niche and an environment, and two species cannot occupy the same niche. And so in this picture, that's just a silly cartoon, but it gives the picture very, very well. These yellow birds are eating in the whole tree. Along comes Redbird, and Redbird starts to eat in the whole tree also, and there's some competition. And so what happens, rather than those two birds duke it out and see which one loses, each bird is going to occupy a particular niche. Redbirds are going to eat off the trunk. The yellow birds are going to eat off the ground and off in the leaves. And so you see the idea here. If the species doesn't adapt, then one of them will die. And so a little bit more about predation. Again, one species eating another species. This could be herbivory, which is, you know, eating plants. It's also considered predation because plants are living things. We don't typically think of it as this, but yeah, it's that. And plants are trying to combat that. The best plants will have a plan against predation. Some plants have thorns and tough outer coverings, and some plants just grow really fast like grass, and that's how they deal with it. And so This is an interaction that's happening a lot. We don't need to think of this as just, like this previous picture where the zebra is getting killed, a la National Geographic, our favorite films or whatever. This is a lot more going on here. Another type of plus minus re or interaction in the environment is called parasitism. It's a little different than predation in that the parasite is not trying to kill the host at first anyway. And so the parasite is something that is stealing resources from its host, but not hurting it completely. There are different kinds of parasites. These can be used by terms like ecto for outside, like a mosquito. Endoparasite is an inside parasite. This is like a tapeworm in your body. Then there are parasitoid organisms. Parasitoidism is where an insect lays eggs inside of its host so that they will hatch out of its host. The eggs hatch and then eat the insides of their host and then eventually explode out and go on about their merry way. Now, when it comes to predation, there are several types of protections against that. Cryptic coloration or camouflage. This is an example of that where you have this here bird is hiding, or there's a lot of examples of camouflage in the animal kingdom. Think of like the baby deer lying in the grass. You could walk by it and probably not see it because they're really good at hiding and being still. This is a survival mechanism. They don't survive if they run and play with the coyotes, for instance. Now, some organisms do the opposite. They just go ahead and color themselves as brightly as possible. This is called aposematic coloring, which is basically, look at me, I'm dangerous. So this frog is really brightly colored, warning other animals, don't eat me because I'll kill you. And so that has a similar kind of effect. They're still not being eaten. There are some other kinds of protections against this. One is called mimicry, and Batesian mimicry being one type of that. And Batesian mimicry is basically where you have a harmless animal, like a caterpillar, that is mimicking a harmful animal, like a snake. This caterpillar has learned to make its body look like a snake head. It's probably a lot less likely to be eaten by a bird because most birds don't go looking for snake heads, but they do go looking for caterpillars. And so here's another picture of this. If you saw that sticking its head out of the leaves, you would leave it alone, even though it's not a head. It's just a caterpillar trying to not get eaten today. And another type of mimicry is called Müllerian mimicry. And this is where you have two harmful species that look like one another. And the basic idea here is if one species is not getting eaten because it is noxious to a predator, maybe it stings or something like that, well, then if another species can look just like it, then it will also not get eaten. And so, in a way, they're kind of protecting one another. Anything that looks like that, stay away from it. This is why a lot of bees have this kind of coloration. A lot of wasps have that same kind of shape and coloration as well. We know to avoid them. Now, another type of relationship that is seen in the wild is called mutualism. Mutualism is a plus-plus relationship in which both organisms benefit from this type of relationship. This is a kind of coevolution, in a sense, which we'll talk about in a later unit. But these species have evolved together in order to help one another. This particular instance shows these ants that live inside of a tree, and the tree actually provides nourishment for the plant or for the ants by these little orange popcorn kernel looking things that are like sugar, and the ants will harvest them and farm them. And then when something comes along to eat the leaves of this plant, the ants will swarm its face and make the animal think twice about coming back to that tree. And so they help one another. Well, commensalism is the last type of relationship that we're going to look at, and this is a plus zero relationship in that one organism is receiving benefit The other organism is theoretically receiving nothing. Cattle egrets are a great example of this. These are birds that ride on the back of large herbivores, and the herbivore meanders its way through the grass and eats, and the cattle egret rides on its back. And when the big beast stirs up bugs, the cattle egret will eat them. The beast doesn't care about the gnats that fly around it, but the bird sure does love them. And so the bird is receiving a benefit. The cow isn't necessarily receiving anything, and so that's why we give it that plus zero distinction.